Monday morning. I hope you all are awake and alert. My name is David Eriksson. I'm Chief Creative of North Kingdom. Sorry, Mickey, for stealing your place on stage, but I was really excited to get up here, and I have a lot to talk about, so I'm going to try to keep up the tempo. I've had the privilege to work with an amazing team since 2003. Amazing team of designers, engineers, UX people, 3D artists, creatives, CFOs, administrators, all kinds of people. They're all very amazingly talented at what they do, and they're also very amazing people. We have three offices. We have our headquarters here in Skellefteå. We're around 16 people. We also have an office in Stockholm, which is the biggest, 24 people, and then a small office in LA. And then we have small satellites scattered across Sweden, Gothenburg, Umeå, Klavreström, or Gävle. This is an old image. People have joined and left since then, but I don't think it matters, because if you work for North Kingdom, you're kind of part of the North Kingdom tribe. And all these people have put amazingly amount of work and passion into creating amazing stuff for very demanding global brands. And these are some of the brands we've been working with over the years. Disney, Netflix, Google, 90% of what we do is on export. 50% of our revenue is in US. We worked across the whole world, except actually I realized we haven't worked in South America. I don't know if it has something to do when we had a few years ago, we got an email from someone of Leo Messi's entourage. They want to create an online project with him. And the response was that Roger, he responded to that email and said, I don't trust South Americans when we wanted to discuss the project. The problem was that he also CC'd the client. So since then, it's been totally quiet from South America. Wonder why. What is it that we do? Well, as north of Sweden, we prefer to show than actually talk about what we do. So lean back and enjoy. So always when I show that, there's always someone in the audience that's, after watching this, they're like, yeah, but so what is it that you actually do? So we also try to describe it in words. And this is the simple explanation what we do as a design agency for the experience aids, that we help our clients innovate experiences, products, and digital services that are meaningful and relevant in people's lives. And then there's always, what do you mean? And then I say, well, we work with the internet, that's basic. So we've been quite successful. You mentioned the awards that we've sort of won over the years, and That's, of course, nice to win awards, but for me, this was one of the highlights of my career, actually. It's an organization called Working Not Working, one of the biggest freelancing organizations in US. They did a survey among their members in US, and they got 5,000 responses. And the question was, which company would you be able to give up your freedom to work for? That was the simple question. And they got many responses, and they selected the top 70, maybe it was top 50 companies that people, freelancers, creative people in US would love to work for. And when this first came, I didn't know. I was kind of, yeah, it's interesting. I would like to work for Tesla. I'd like to work for Pixar. I'd like to work for NASA. Blizzard, yeah, definitely I'd love to work for Blizzard. And then I, when I was sort of eyeing the article, I was like, North Kingdom. And I didn't really understand what our name was up there. But we were actually one of the top 50 companies in US that freelancers would love to work for. That's quite cool. So I think it's not so illa pinkat for a company from Skellefteå to actually be on that list. I was asked to come here and talk about the work we do, but I thought I'd also connect with the theme of the first day of the BizBuzz week, which is digitization and digital transformation. Because I think it's digital transformation is one of those buzzwords that people are throwing around like it was, I don't know, snowballs. And for me, the question is really, what do we mean when we talk about digitization? What do we mean? Digital transformation. Anyone has a definition of digitization? No? No one knows what digitization means. Sorry? Change? That's a good one. Anyone else? Making something digital? Yes. I tried to make my own definition of it. As technology advances exponentially, it enables new innovations and new ways of unleashing human creativity. That's a good definition, isn't it? Digitization in itself is a process. Digital transformation is the effect that the process reaches. And I think it's important to understand that if you think that things are moving fast now, it's just the beginning. It's exponentially increasing the speed of change. And you might ask yourself, what is the end game with digitization? Where will it lead us as humans, as humanity? I played with a thought, and this is something for you to think about afterwards. Please don't do it now. If we consider technology as a life form, yes, it's Terminator, kind of, would we consider it to be parasitic or symbiotic on humankind? That's something to think about. So, if technology was considered a life form, would we think about it as parasitic or symbiotic on humankind? I'll leave that. You seem like, what does he actually mean? My first encounter with digitization was in the mid-90s, working as a teacher at Kågeskolan, at the high school. Kågeskolan was at the time the newest school in Skellefteå kommun. And one of the big advantages was that teachers had working rooms, and each teacher had a computer, a PC. That was new at the time. And I'm like starting there the first day at coming into my workroom, looking at the computer. I'm like, sweet, can I play Warcraft on it? That was my first initial thought. But I soon realized, after actually trying to find out where I put it on, I actually found out that this was a very powerful tool for me in my teaching, to find information, to sort, but also plan my work. And then I also found out that it was a powerful tool for learning, because I had students that weren't really the ones that could sit still in the chairs. They wanted, young guys wanted to run about, and they were very tactile. Some of them just responded to audio and had difficulty in writing and reading. But I found that technology could help me adapt information in a way that it was easier for my students to learn. And then I realized I didn't want to be a teacher. I wanted to find out more what technology could enable me to do to bring a message to an audience. So I went to school here at Skiria. Multimedia Produktion was the name of the school for 2 years. Our first project for North Kingdom was also a project that very much was in this process of digitization and digital transformation. Vodafone came to us with the question, I don't know if you remember, 2003, after the IT bubble, at the verge of mobile communication, 3G was discussed. Why should you invest so many millions in 3G masts, etc., when we could invest it in schools and healthcare, which is usually the normal response. And Vodafone wanted us to help them in visualizing that 10 to 15 years from 2003, mobile communication will be at the center of work, life, society, etc. So we first asked our question, is technology important for us? Yes, it is, but it's not technology in itself. It's the way it changes, the way we communicate, the way we play, the way we work, etc. So that was the first important learning. And then we also started thinking about, well, how do you bring out the message? How do you talk to someone? How do you make someone interested in what you want to communicate? And then we formed something which is basically has been the rules of storytelling from day one. We call it the rules of engagement. You need to be entertaining, you need to capture, you need to talk to people's heart, you need to make them emotionally engaged before you actually talk to them about what you want them to learn. So be entertaining, and then you need to provide a value, something for your audience to take away from it. And third but not least, if you manage to create, to touch people's heart, and if you manage to talk to their brains, provide a value, your audience will want to talk about it in their context. So the third dimension is social. You need to provide tools for the story to be spread in many different contexts. This project, this is actually from the pitch, the document when we went there and pitched the idea that, well, 10 to 15 years from 2003, things won't look that differently. But in the background, there will be technology that changes the way, for example, the daughter and her father is doing their homework in the kitchen. So when, and we involved researchers on ubiquitous computing from KTH on this project to come up with scenarios that would be probable. So this is not a daughter with an ordinary paper. She's actually sitting with a flat screen where you can communicate with computers through mobile wireless connection, something that later on, 10 years later, was named the cloud. She can communicate with classmates, and she can have her files work with documents on that. So 7 years before, or seven, maybe 5 years before the tablet actually came to life, we thought about those ideas in 2003. This went on, and it's called Vodafone Future Vision, became the world's most awarded digital project in 2004. We had many different, this is actually from the actual project where we had four scenarios in an entertaining, working, belonging, and caring situation. We had many different ideas. You see, we had this idea that maybe you could wear something on your wrist that allowed you to keep track of your health and give you advice on how to, maybe you should walk something more, walk a little bit more around today because you haven't moved that much. Many ideas that actually became reality within 5 to 7 years, half the time that we expected it to do. And we had used researchers from KTH, the best people in the world, in figuring out how our future will be. And still, it happened within half the time. We were totally underestimating the speed at which digitization was happening. So, the speed. This is a quite complex chart, but you only need to look at the red line. So it's basically describing, it's a continuation of Moore's law, so that was defined by the founder of Intel in 1965. And later, Ray Kurzweil defined something that it was not just about the increased computer capacity, it was also about, which is double up the amount of transistors on the chip every other year. But it's actually not just that is increasing, it's the speed of change and that rate curves are defined. And this curve is exponential. Exponential is difficult for the human mind to understand. It means, concretely, that 90% of the data that we have today didn't exist 2 years ago. 90% of the data we have today didn't exist 2 years ago. And then we move 2 years into the future and think about what it means for data and what kind of information we will have. And this chart, exponential curve, we're at 2016. It's just the beginning of the curve. If you think that things are moving fast now, it will be much, much faster very, very soon. And you could say that this image shows at which speed digitization is happening and will happen. But this is just about technology. It's not about human behavior. And I think our principle at North Kingdom has, well, technology is evolving, changing fast, but we humans, we are slower than technology. So human behavior is not changing exponentially. And how do you match the two? Just because you can doesn't mean that you should. So to innovate products and services that are meaningful and relevant, that actually people can use, you need to start with the human first. You need to tap into people's minds. You need to understand how they would want to use a digital service or a product or an experience. And that has been the base principle from day one. Yes, let's use technology, but let's start with humans first. I thought I'd take you through some cases. It's a lot of movie watching. Makes it easier for me, not so much talking. And some of the work we've done for clients. And Disney has been since we did our first project in 2007, 2006. Is Danne still around? Yeah, I think it was 2007 that Danne, that is now running Pixelgruvan, was involved in a big project for Disney Parks and Resorts in Epcot. So we've had a long-lasting relationship, mostly with Parks and Resort. And this was a project that came out of when Magic Kingdom in Orlando made their biggest expansion ever. They were building a whole new area of the park, which was called Fantasyland. And the problem was that when they were building this, they already wanted to start selling tickets, like four or six months ahead. And basically, the park was nothing than a construction site. So how do you start selling tickets to something that doesn't exist? How do you visualize it in a way that moms, which was the target group, that they directly push the buy button, yes, I want to go there the moment it's done? And we were tasked with that. So we got all the CAD drawings and started working on a project that was about visualizing Fantasyland, but also sell tickets before it was even done.
The construction of New Fantasyland brought with it the largest expansion in Magic Kingdom history. As only Disney could do, we united classic Disney stories with an interactive experience that would give New Fantasyland a reason for being. It asked the question, what if the place we call New Fantasyland has actually always been there?
Once upon a time, we had a need for stories, and there was a wonderful land where these tales actually took place. But slowly, our dreams of childhood went from wishing on a star to wishing that we would grow up. And so, we did.
We let evil play its part, hiding the land by stealing four symbols that you must retrieve.
In this land, your search is for a magical feather.
Narration by David Ogden Steers, a fully adaptive orchestral soundtrack and lush explorable landscapes brought our story to life. Land by land, you can reawaken the power of your childhood memories the only thing potent enough to break the Evil Queen's spell. And in the real world, evidence of your heroics will live on in the park forever. In the end, it was you who revealed New Fantasyland to the world and broke the curse once and for all. Or did you?
So, this was a very experimental project for Disney. But actually, they made the money on the ticket sales through the website. They sort of the investment they made on this project, they got a return of investment within 2 weeks. And they also saw the power of gamification, because in this, we used gamification to lure the mothers into the website. Yes, lure, that is what we do. Lure them into the websites, take them on a virtual walkthrough of the park, and then eventually say, of course you want to go here in 4 months. Buy tickets here. Disney is, if you didn't know it, they're not about stories and stuff. They're about making money. They're very, very business-oriented. And they have a consumer journey of 7 steps. And each and every step of the consumer journey, they have a moment, which they call the moment of transaction, defined. And later on, this is actually from a project we did when Disney came to us and asked, they actually, you can find yourself bound by the systems that you are working on today, and it can restrict the way you think creatively about the future. So they came to us and asked for a future vision on how should Disney parks and resorts engage their consumers in the future, 3 to 5 years from now, on all digital interfaces. And what we did, so this is a model that we work with most of our clients. We defined the consumer journey. We looked at what are the different steps. Another important phase for us is actually looking at context. You've heard of, probably some of you heard about responsive design. We don't care about responsive design because that's actually a technical view on it. We think about contextual design, which means in which context do we envision that the user will be sitting, lying, standing when they interact, when they dream about going to Disney parks and resorts. Which context will they be planning? Probably with the family around the table, and how can the digital interface support their conversation, their dialogue, etc., at that very moment. What this also do, it helps us define moments in time where we see, well, here's nothing. And in this specific journey, we actually found that, okay, you can dream about going to park and resorts, you can do research, you can plan with the family, you can book, which is usually done 4 to 6 months before you go there. 4 to 6 months, where for Disney it was a huge gap. No communication, maybe some emails going back and forth. But that was an opportunity that we helped them see that here's a moment where you can have a much more closer connection with your consumer. You can start preparing them so the visit at the park becomes more effective and more, you know, well, prepared, which they didn't know before we actually lined this up for them. And this is something that we've been using ever since. Here's another project, Google and Lego. Let's keep lining up dream clients. Google, this was back in 2012. Lego was celebrating its 50-year anniversary in Australia. And Google wanted to celebrate and put that up. Well, they actually wanted to make money out of Lego, I would say. Because they wanted to do something on their own platform, which is the Chrome web browser, an experience around the Lego 50-year anniversary, and sort of a collaboration with Lego. So the idea that we put forward when they came to us was really, well, what happens if we combine the two of best worlds, Google and Google Maps? Everyone knows Google Maps. And what if you can mark an area anywhere in the world and actually select that as your base for your Lego build? So initially, we started with Australia, and it was a campaign meant to be for 4 months, but it became a long-lasting platform that is still alive today, and many teachers in the US use this platform for building with Lego in the classroom, because it's cheap. You don't have any plastic brick. You can use your browser for it. This is the... tells you a little bit about the product. Thank you. this platform has been living ever since, actually. And it became, this project became our entry point to Lego that has been a strategic partner of ours ever since. I think it's just interesting when you see people interacting with this platform, because the first thing is they do is they look up their home street, and then they select where their house is, and then they build a red house on that place. But very soon you can see that you start searching for strange places or unique places, and then you try to build something that is a reference to that place. So I really encourage you to go online and explore, imagine what you would build, and then build something. You should look at the square, for example. There are some amazing replicas of the statue we have on the square. So this was the entry point into Lego, and Lego has ever since been a strategic partner of ours. We do many different projects for them. One of them is for Lego Star Wars that is based in US in Enfield. They have sort of abandoned, well, it varies from year to year, but they have abandoned a website strategy and they have an app strategy because they see that kids don't go to websites. Kids use apps. And they try it, and then they throw it, or it stays on the iPad or the mobile. So this project was for Star Wars. They wanted to explore how can we make a digital product. Doesn't cost anything, but it's still a product that engages and encourages creative play from physical to digital environment, connected then to the Star Wars universe. And if you haven't tried this, I really encourage you to try it with your kids, because they usually love it. It's not a game. We can't call it a game because Lego are not allowed to make games. Warner Brothers has licensed that. So it's a platform for creative play, where you use the Force to build with Lego. And it's this video that we made, which is American style, is actually shot here in Skellefteå.
Coming to you from a galaxy far, far away, it's the new Lego Star Wars Force Builder app. Challenge yourself to master your Force. You have the power to build any ship you can imagine. Build, color, and customize your ships in your own hangar. Choose your pilot and go on a test run. Take on build challenges from the heroes of Star Wars. Can you help them build and repair their vehicles? If so, challenge complete. Yeah. Build and rebuild. Share your ships with your friends.
Coming, Mom.
You can build your own Lego Star Wars ships using the new Lego Force Builder app. Download for free from the App Store. Ask parents' permission first.
So I mentioned that we do quite a few different projects with them. One of them is that they're actually now in Billund, they're building a Lego house. If you think that Legoland is owned by Lego, you think wrong. Legoland is not owned by Lego, but they realized the importance of having a physical space for people to come and experience Lego up close. So we're building the digital app that connects the experience around the house before going there, when you're there exploring all the different creative rooms, and after, where it basically documents your memories and you can share it with friends. But it's interesting to see how that project with Google and Lego actually led us quite deep into working with Lego and having a strategic alliance with them. Speed up. Star Wars. Just the power of being not Norrländsk. Me and Martin, the CEO of North Kingdom in Stockholm, we were in San Francisco meeting with Google and other clients, and we knew that Lucasfilm had their headquarters in San Francisco, and we're like, it would be really nice to see the headquarters of Lucasfilm. And Martin went, yeah, I might have a contact that knows someone inside Lucasfilm, so I'll send them an email. And this was like on the evening. In the morning, we were waking up, and we had just a morning of free time, so we had an email saying, yeah, you're welcome, come to our office in Presidio, I think it's called. We had no idea who the person was, and we just went there. Amazing place. Yoda is a fountain outside, and then you have all the original Darth Vaders and Boba Fett, etc., inside the reception. So we sat there nervous, walking around with cool stuff, playing with Star Wars gadgets. Know that someone's going to pick us up and show us around what we think. So this guy comes and picks us up, Kim Libreri, we found out was his name later on, VP of Technology at Lucasfilm. And he was like, took us inside. Well, this is our office. Come this way. And we went into a flygel. I don't know what you call that, an area of the office that looked really, really fancy. So I was walking down there looking at amazing posters, etc. And I'm like, well, this is fancy. Well, this is where the board and all the VPs sits, the management. Oh, okay. So I was just expecting us to walk through. And then we were going to be in the board meeting room at the end of this hallway. So I'm like, oh, nice. So as we walk through the hallway, I pass a small room. And you know that feeling when you walk by and then you see an old man sitting on a sofa on the phone? And you're like, I've seen him before. And you give the person the nod, but you don't really remember. So you're like, howdy. And then you walk by. And the moment you step by, you're like, that was George Lucas. So, and then we went into the meeting room, and Kim is like, yeah, he's on the phone with Bob. Bob? Well, Bob Iger is the CEO of Disney. And they were actually discussing the deal when Disney bought Lucasfilm. So I was in the room next door when they were making it, talking about that. Yes. But it took us here. So we actually, this project started at Lucasfilm, but then became Disney Interactive. So we did concept design and UX. Then Disney Interactive did the tech themselves. Their strategy was they wanted to have a direct line of communication with their fan base. So they wanted to develop an app that really felt like it was within the Star Wars universe, but also where they could sell tickets and other stuff. So it became the Star Wars app. All Star Wars, all the time, anywhere.
May the Force be with you.
So it's a quite cool project. Another client, I'm actually going to skip this because we're running late, but you can check it out on our homepage. Lately, what we have seen the last 2 years is that from US, I would say mostly, it's an increase, incredible demand for VR solutions. And FX, which is the network behind American Horror Story series, came to us and asked us to create an experience around that series that we did in San Diego for Comic-Con in San Diego. And it's a really crazy, scary shit, honestly. So if you dare, you can actually just come by our office. We can show you that stuff.
Welcome.
Yeah. So that was all projects. Currently, this is some of the projects we're working on. I really wished that I could show some of these projects because, if Hobbit gave me the goosebumps, I don't know what HBO gives me. Google. We're doing a really interesting project on children's safety online, which is a very, very important topic. McDonald's, we're helping visualizing the future, their future restaurant experience. HBO, we're doing secret stuff for. Supercell, we're helping with two of their four products. Uber, we're working with, that's all global. Uber in APAC, we're helping them. It's a very competitive market, so we're helping them, I would say, with branding. And Ferrari, we're currently working with their 70-year anniversary, which is due on the 14th of March this year. They're all very different solutions, but we all have the same base of starting point, which is that I've been talking about, which we call the empathic design process, where we try to start with the audience first. It's basically observing and capturing data and do an analysis and then brainstorm on top of that and prototype. And it's an iterative process, so you go back from the beginning. I'm not going to bore you more with that. Why you need to have this is because technology is advancing at such speed that human behavior is not catching up. So you need to understand what might be the way that our consumers will be interact with this project or this product or this service. What is driving change? We look at six different areas. Not all of them are interesting for us, but we need to be aware of them. is called the Innovation Accelerators. Someone at EDC came up with that, I think. But they're really interesting because they defined six areas where, well, different topics will drive digital transformation and really change the way we work, play, communicate, but also change the way our clients will have revenue streams. So we need to help our clients understand what's happening in the world, how can you capitalize on different things. VR is, as I mentioned, a very big area, but it's very far away from commercialization, actually making money out of it. It's still very much be out there and show, like in the beginning of homepages, everyone needed a homepage, but you didn't really know why you needed it. It's the same thing where we are with VR now. How many in this room have tried VR? It's about more than 50%, that's good. How many use VR regularly? That's about 2%. I think it's interesting to think about because it's something that we all talk about, but not that many actually have tried. This is supposed to be an area where most people that know things should be. But actually, most people haven't tried VR yet. And there's a lot of talk about it. But VR really have the power to make us experience things, places, events that we wouldn't in our real life have the possibility. Over the Christmas holiday, I've been Batman. I've really been Batman in VR. I encourage you to try it out. It was really cool to be Batman in VR. These guys have specialized in creating virtual reality experiences inside physical environments. And I tried there, they had an exhibition at Madame Tussauds in New York, and I tried Ghostbusters, where you're actually running around in a space and you're catching ghosts, and it feels like you're inside. There's still some work to be done on the visuals, but it actually felt like you're part of it. It was really, really fun. This is about gaming. I would say that VR or AR, I don't know if you heard about Magic Leap, but it's one of those finance. They're valued at $4.5 billion without having released any product. And it's an augmented reality product. You can watch that forever. I'm going to do like that. Well, it's interesting that they're using... They're using AR. And not just in a gaming context, they're thinking about it much broader. And the expectations when they launch their first product at the end of this year or beginning of next year is going to be immense. But no one really knows if it's going to be a success. There's a lot of money investing in it, but there's no sure thing that it's going to be a success. Look at Google Glass. Does anyone remember Google Glass? was like the biggest topic only 1 year ago, or is it more? But now it doesn't really exist. So AR, VR is, of course, a big area. Robotics is another one. You might think that robots are stupid. How many have a robotic lawnmower? One, right? Anyone has one of those dust busters? Yes, more. How many have given them names? Actually, most people do give them names. Isn't that interesting? Yes. That you give them names. And this, I think, is a good example because it's not just a robot. It actually triggers something deeply within us as humans. The machine actually triggers very human and basic emotions. Who wouldn't want one of these? And until this very moment, it's a machine that's taking care of your dishes, moves in a kind of uncanny way, take care of the garbage. But that's something reserved actually for us laughing at humans and cats on the internet. But suddenly we're giving on the machine emotional feelings. There's another clip that I didn't show, but where the engineer is actually kicking the robot just to demonstrate the ability to keep straight. And your feeling is not, oh cool, it can keep its balance. It's like, stop kicking the robot, damn it. So if you see this come running through the forest, I guess run as fast as you can. And just as a side note, you know that in Brussels they're discussing to have electronic personalities right now. Actually, robots can have electronic personalities. And in doing that, they also need to have a kill switch. So if something goes wrong, you can stop it, which is interesting. We're giving machines rights. Alicia Vikander is this, if you don't recognize. This was a project on in Austin, Texas, 2 years ago. They used Tinder as a way to market the new movie, Ex Machina. Alicia is one of the main characters in that movie. And when guys were on Tinder and swiping, she would appear. Of course, she looks nice, so most guys would swipe right. And then she would swipe right as well, so you would be able to communicate with her. The thing is that there's no person alive behind it. It's a chatbot. There's an AI that is actually communicating with me as a guy that is really trying to get a date with this beautiful woman. And most guys didn't understand that she was a robot. They thought that she was for real. And per definition, if you look at the Turing test, that actually makes it into an AI. The moment where we humans can't distinguish the difference between a machine or a robot. Further down the Uncanny Valley, this is really interesting project. Sorry, I need to speed up. This is made by a Russian developer, a woman, that had a friend, a dear friend. The story doesn't tell if they're lovers. But this friend, he went and died. And when he was dead, one day she started looking through their chat logs where they had communicated over Messenger. And she realized that she was missing him so much that what if she could recreate his person artificially, like a chatbot, so she could communicate with him whenever she wanted to, despite he was dead. So she actually created a chatbot that allowed her to communicate with him whenever she wanted to. So these are all logs from her, that chatbot, and it's actually, I think it exists for, so you can try it out and download it. And the way is that you put in your questions and the chatbot responds in the way that her dead friend would respond, Roma. And what is then the difference from the response you get from this chatbot than from a real living person? It's still someone who can give you advice and give you answers and et cetera. So science and technology has progressed really to a point where what we build is only constrained by our own imagination, because I wouldn't have thought about recreating a dead friend, go into the chat logs. And the question is, if we can imagine, we can build. How do we push our imagination? And I think that's a very important topic where we need to think about how do we push our imagination. And one of these, like these houses, I think is about that. I think art and creativity, fiction, will play an even bigger role in the future for thinking about what can we do with technology. We also have reached a point where it's not longer about what we can do with technology. It's about what technology does with us. Think about that. Information age has been about what we can do with technology. The next stage will be about what technology does with us as humans. You could call it digital transformation 2.0. And in that, with all those examples, it also puts the focus on, like it used to be, what makes us different from animals. The question is, what makes us different from machines? What makes us humans? That is what we call the experience age. As the information the age that we're coming from, digitalization has been about data efficiency, doing more. I think the experience age will be about, well, I hope that experience age can be about helping us be more humans, to be more emotional creatures. But it could go the other way. The third industrial revolution, or the digital revolution, was the beginning of the information age. World Economic Forum just released a video called The Fourth Industrial Revolution, which I think marks the beginning of the experience age, where digital, physical, and biological system comes together.
The original Industrial Revolution was driven by the discovery that you could use steam engines to do all kinds of interesting things.
That was followed by additional revolutions for electricity and computers and communications technology. We're now in the early stages of the Fourth Industrial Revolution, which is bringing together digital, physical, and biological systems.
One of the features of this Fourth Industrial Revolution is that it doesn't change what we are doing, but it changes us.
We need a different economic model that will allow us to meet the basic needs of every human on the planet, and that will be focused not on growth per se, but on maximizing human well-being.
We have energy technologies that can power our civilization, but how do we get it and implement it at the scale we need at a price that people around the world can afford?
If we're able to do something to transform cities, to make them more efficient, then the impact can be huge.
We can use asset tracking, we can use IT, we can use 3D printing to decouple growth from the resource constraints we have.
The question of adding quality to quantity, it's really about a diverse, safe, healthy, and just world with clean air, clean water, clean energy.
Together we are fighting to preserve our fragile climate from irreversible damage and devastation of unthinkable proportions.
The prediction of 5 million jobs lost by 2020 to technology is serious, but the main question is, how will we define work? How will we share the wealth?
How can you have a doctor that really knows a lot about data? How can you have a biologist that knows about medicine?
We have to create a space that enables people to think freely, to think divergent thoughts, to think creative thoughts.
We really need a new education or new training.
We're working with a world in motion in FIRST Robotics, trying to encourage students from third grade all the way up through the end of high school to pursue science, math, and different technologies.
It's this ability of digital technology to change outcomes, to truly empower people that can create a more equitable growth.
Fourth Industrial Revolution has the potential to make inequalities visible and to make them less acceptable in the future.
I was the first person in the world to be able to voluntarily move my legs while stepping in a robot. The cure will be possible if enough of the right people have the will to make it happen.
We're seeing this incredibly exciting convergence of genome editing, DNA sequencing. Governments have a very important role to play in enabling the safe and effective use of technologies.
We need to take responsibility at every level of society to adapt to these
technological challenges which are redefining what it means to be completely embedded in this world.
Even though we have everyday problems we have to solve, we have to find a way to lay the foundations for the innovations of tomorrow.
There's a 10-minute version of this one online, so just go on World Economic Forum and check it out. Sorry if I scared you. I think it's an amazing time to be alive. There are some challenges, but I think if we put our minds together, we can overcome it. And in that, in creating these kind of environments where public and private sector come together and think about and really lays the foundation for the innovations of tomorrow, I think will be even more important. So I'm really happy to be here today on the inauguration of the Great Northern. Thank you for listening.